I call this the Ephraim Awakening, Redeeming the Bride. That's the title of this presentation. I think most of you already know who I am, but for those of you who don't know who I am, well, I'm a born-again believer in Yeshua. I accepted him when I knew him as Jesus Christ at age 7. Grew up as a PK, a pastor's kid. My dad was a Baptist minister when I was a kid. Like I said, I accepted Christ when I was 7 years old. Grew up in the church. It was all I ever knew, pretty much. As the doors were open, we were there. I am a filmmaker by trade and a researcher and author by hobby, although in recent years that's sort of switched a little bit. I spent most of the last few years doing research and writing books and stuff like that, but as of this month, April, I am switching gears and moving back into what I believe is my original calling, is to get back on working on the TV series called Seed, currently still in pre-production. But when it comes right down to it, really, I'm just a dude reading books. And some would say I'm a crazy dude reading books with a tinfoil hat on. Whatever the case may be, I always start my presentations by saying, don't believe a thing I say. All right? Don't believe me. You know, listen to what I have to say. Take notes if you want to. But I believe that we should all be good Bereans and always search and see if these things be true. And I would definitely encourage you to do that with any of my presentations. Search and see if these things be true. The title at the top of the page you see there on the top of the screen is the Ephraim Awakening. When I first started coming into Torah and all that, you know, and keeping the Sabbath, some of my good Baptist friends automatically, they started thinking, oh, you became a Seventh-day Adventist. I said, no, I didn't. And I started, you know, preaching and talking about the Torah and things like that. And they said, oh, you're part of the Hebrew Roots Movement. I'm like, no, I'm not. I don't even know what that is. And, you know, everybody wanted to slap this label on me. And I'm like, okay, fine. If you want a label, I'm part of the whole Bible movement. And I basically tore out the commercial interruptions that were not Holy Spirit inspired. You know, the page that says Old Testament and New Testament? I just tore those out. So basically my Bible started with the table of contents and went all the way to the maps. And it's one complete story. And I believe the whole thing. And I was going by that label for quite a while, and I thought it worked, until I really started to understand what this thing is that people are calling the Hebrew Roots Movement. And the reason I distanced myself from that title is because in recent years, certain personalities, I think, have kind of risen in prominence to be synonymous with the term. So when you hear Hebrew Roots Movement, you automatically go to, you know, so-and-so. And some of these people are coming out with some pretty crazy, wild, and wacky stuff that I don't agree with. And some of these people want to throw Paul out. You know, they think he's a heretic. They want to tear Paul out of your Bible. Some are disregarding Yeshua as the Messiah. Some are trying to get back into polygamy because, you know, all the patriarchs were. So I'm like, you know what? Don't put that label on me. I don't want to be associated with that. But when I realized what was happening with this so-called Hebrew Roots Movement, and I was reading the parable of the prodigal son, I had this vision in my mind of, I believe the prodigal son is basically talking about the northern kingdom, Ephraim, of this individual waking up in the pig pen. You guys know the parable, right? He squanders everything and he gets to the end and he's like in this pig pen. And I had this image in my head, like this Polaroid snapshot of that moment when he woke up. Not just from sleep, but from all that he had been doing, and realized what had happened to his life. And he says, wow, I mean, here he is with pigs of all things, right? And he says, man, I wonder if Dad will take me back. And like, if you could just take a snapshot of that moment, that's what I believe is happening around the world. I called it the Ephraim Awakening. As far as I know, I hadn't heard that term from anybody else before. You know, it's something I think I made up, but anyway, that's what I started calling myself as a member of the Ephraim Awakening, because I was looking at other great awakenings that have taken place in this country and elsewhere, and I'm going, this is the greatest of all of them. And, you know, just to illustrate that, if you've seen the front page of the Virtual House Church, I have this graphic there. This is an app. Actually got it off of the 119 Ministries website. All those blue dots represent people just like you in various stages of waking up, that are having home Bible study fellowship groups and going back to Genesis and starting over. And, you know, like I mentioned last night, some people think this whole thing's a cult. I'm like, well, you know, a cult has a person that usually rises up with some crazy idea, gets a bunch of followers. But there's no leader here except the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit's the leader. These are individuals just waking up one day going, you know what, I think my Bible doesn't begin in Matthew. I'm going to go back to Genesis and start reading it. Oh, and Galatians is not the only book in my Bible. Huh. Wow. Cool. You know? So this is the Ephraim Awakening, in my opinion. It's a greatest love story. It's the love story of how Yahuwah redeemed his unfaithful bride. And it's also illustrated in a number of ways, and we'll talk about some of them throughout this presentation. But of course, the parable of the prodigal son, I think, is one of the main ways that is illustrated, and this picture shows that right there. The content of this presentation comes largely from a teaching I did back in December of 2014. It was called the Yahuwah Triangle, and I have that presentation here as DVDs if you'd like them. But it's also, all of that content is available for free at that website address you see right there. I'm not going to keep it on the screen for long, so if you miss it, you can ask me about it again later, but it's all online for free. And that teaching came as a result of looking at Isaiah chapter 19. The whole chapter, really, but the latter verses really caught my attention one day. It says, in that day shall Israel be the third with Egypt and with Assyria, even a blessing in the midst of the land. Has this happened yet? You think Israel's a blessing in the land with those countries? I don't think so. I think this is still yet to happen. Whom the Lord of hosts shall bless, saying, blessed be Egypt, my people, and Assyria, the work of my hands, and Israel, mine inheritance. So I'm looking at a map, and I just kind of plotted out three locations right there, because we're talking about Egypt, right, and Assyria, and Israel. And obviously, if you connect the dots, you end up with a triangle. So hence the title, the Yahuwah Triangle. Now, you'll notice I use the name Yahuwah. This is not something that I think we should be dividing over. A lot of people struggle and, you know, want to fight and everything about how do you pronounce the Yod-Heh-Vav-Heh, the Tetragrammaton, right? Of course, King James says Jehovah, and then some people say, well, there's no J, so it's really Yehovah. And some say, well, there's not really any V, so it's Yahuwah. And then, of course, you have others say Yahweh is probably the most common one people will use. And then there's Yahuwah. I have personally gone through all of them. And at different points in my life, I was like, I think that's the way it's supposed to be. And I've currently landed on Yahuwah. And one of the reasons I did was because of looking at some of the other names in the Bible, looking at a website like behindthename.com, and looking at the names of the prophets, where you have prophets that have the name of God incorporated into their name, like Jeremiah, Yirmiyahu, Yahuwah has uplifted, or Eliyahu, Elijah, my God is Yod-Heh-Vav-Heh. Or Yashayahu, or Isaiah, Yod-Heh-Vav-Heh is salvation. So I'm like, well, I mean, if that's how they pronounce their names and they had the name of God incorporated into their name, then maybe it's Yahuwah. I'm not dogmatic about it. If you say Yahweh or Jehovah, whatever, I don't think it's something we should be fighting about. We're looking at a name that consists of four consonants. And when you look at some of the like Paleo-Hebrew and stuff like that, how many of you know, so some of the other presentations already showed this earlier today, that the letters in Hebrew not only have numerical value, but the letters themselves also have meaning, right? Anybody know what the meaning of the four letters of Yahuwah's name are? Yeah. For those of you who did not hear that, you have the hey is reading left to right. If they read right, let's go right to left like they do. The yod is hand. The hey is behold, the vav is nail, and the other hey is behold. So you basically end up with something like hand behold, nail behold, or behold the hand, behold the nail. Right? How interesting that that's the name of God, right? And some people have taken modern Hebrew and got creative with it, and it's, you use the yod hey vav hey, and you kind of end up with the man right there. And you look out throughout the scriptures, and you see verses like this in Exodus 15:6. Your right hand, Yahuwah, has become glorious in power. Your right hand, Yahuwah, has dashed the enemy in pieces. When it says, behold the hand, behold the nail, care to guess which hand we're talking about? Yeah, it's open book test, right? I got it on the screen. Yeah, I believe Yeshua is the right hand of the Father right there. And somebody got creative with the name Yeshua and made a hand out of that too, taking the letters and putting them together, and you end up with a hand. Pretty cool. Isaiah 41:10. Don't be afraid, for I am with you. Don't be dismayed, for I am your God. I will strengthen you. I will help you. I will hold you up with my victorious right hand. Amen. Huh? That's awesome. In the Yahuwah Triangle series, I started out talking about the earlier part of Isaiah 19:19 through 20, where it talks about this altar that will be in the midst of the land of Egypt, a pillar in the border of it, in the middle of Egypt. And I began to speculate, is this talking about the Great Pyramid of Giza? And I thought I was really onto some pretty cool stuff until I did some research and found out a whole lot of other people were already on this trail and already written about it for hundreds of years. I'm like, wow, okay, cool. Many of it's, I would admit, is speculation. But I think there's pretty good circumstantial evidence to suggest that this is, in fact, the monument that's being spoken of in Isaiah 19. So then I began to wonder why. Why would that be there? Why that specific location? Again, I freely admit this is totally speculation on my part. But in the first lecture, I speculate and suggest that that may have been the sand or the dirt or the clay from which Adam was pulled. That Adam was pulled from the dust of the Giza Plateau. Later, he was placed eastward in a land called Eden into a garden, eastward in Eden. And so back in 2009, I drew this graphic, and this was the early stage of kind of figuring this stuff out, and didn't really know exactly what it represented. I just kind of graphically depicted it back in 2009, and then 2014, I felt this tap on my shoulder, and I felt like God was saying, okay, now it's time to unpack that. Let's look at this. And what I think I've discovered is that there's a pattern that works between the Yahuwah Triangle. That there's always something that is either birthed, created, or renewed in Egypt. And it is placed from Egypt then into the land that we now call Israel. And you're good to go there until you violate the house rules. And then where do you think you go? Babylon, to the east. And so much of the scriptures I found kind of ping pong between these locations. You repent in Babylon, you get to go back to Israel. Pretty cool. So that's sort of my general concept on the Yahuwah Triangle. And part two of the Yahuwah Triangle, I came to the conclusion, again, it's speculation, but I think it's reasonable speculation, that the promised land is the garden. The garden, what we call the promised land, is where the Garden of Eden was in the pre-flood world. And there's a number of scriptures that seem to indicate that, at least to me anyway, where we see right there in Genesis 13, You have Abraham and Lot kind of having this dispute, and you know, you pick where you want to go, and Lot lifted up his eyes, right? And he looks, he said that area that he wanted to go was even as the garden of the Lord. We see in Joel chapter 2, blow a trumpet in Zion, right? And then it goes on to say the land is as the garden of Eden before them. We see also in other scriptures here in Ezekiel, it says, say unto the house of Israel, and then it goes on and says, look, I'm going to take you from the heathen and gather you out of all the countries and bring you into your own land. I'll put my spirit in you and cause you to walk in my statutes. You shall keep my judgments and do them. You shall dwell in the land that I gave to your fathers. You shall be my people, and I will be your God. And it goes on to say, the land was desolate, that was desolate has become like the Garden of Eden. And then we see again in Isaiah 51:3, talking to Zion, that it would be like the Garden of Eden. So these are what I would take, looking at this, as confirming scriptures, that that's why that plot of land. I mean, do you ever just sit around and wonder, why is God so concerned with this one plot of land, of all the earth? Well, I think that that's where fellowship was initially broken, that's where fellowship with God was reconciled, and that's where we're going in the end. We're all going to end up back over there. So I think it's one big story that originates with the Garden of Eden. And that's why that land is important. How big is that land? Is the little sliver that we talk about in the evening news? No. One of the presentations this morning, I think it was Carl, showed the land. It's the promised land, wherever your feet touch. I thought that was like way cool when he was showing the sandals being carved. When he first put the slide up with the sandals, I'm like, why were they carving, you know, pictures of their sandals, until you bring that scripture up, wherever your feet go, I'm like, oh, well, that makes sense. You know, and I think his border was a little bigger than what you see here. Some people suggest this might be the total land. Others might suggest something like this. And right now, I'm kind of the opinion that this might be the upper darkened area, only because God was going to bring them into the promised land after they wandered in the wilderness. And so if when they were wandering in the wilderness was the promised land, that doesn't really fit because they would already be in the promised land. Whatever the case may be, we know that Adam and Eve are in the garden, right? What got Adam and Eve kicked out of the garden? Disobedience, exactly. Yes, disobedience equals exile from the garden. We see out of the garden, the Lord caused to grow every tree that is pleasing to the sight and good for food, the tree of life also in the midst of the garden, and the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. And, you know, he's basically like, you know, of every tree you can eat, just you can't have from that one. They had one commandment. You know, people are like, is it 613 commandments? There's 10 commandments? They had two commandments? They had one. And they screwed it up. One commandment. Don't eat from that one tree. Who sinned? Who is sin accounted toward? Adam or Eve? Yeah. Wherefore, by one man, sin entered the world, and death by sin. And so, death passed upon all men, that all have sinned. What is sin? Disobedience, specifically transgression of the law. Open book test, right? Very interesting. We'll talk about it a little bit more, but I want you to keep that in mind, that, you know, when we, especially in the upbringing that I had, we hear the word sin, it's just this kind of nebulous thing, right? Missing the mark. What is the mark? It's archery term. You know, we hear all these things, but the Bible tells you point blank, sin is transgression of the law. I don't know what your experience is, but just post anything on Facebook about, God forbid, as Christians, we should obey God, and watch how psycho Christians will go on. The same people that will preach against sin. The same people that will go psycho whenever they want to take the Ten Commandments out of schools and government buildings. But you say, hey, why don't we keep the Ten Commandments? Oh, you're a legalist! You're a mama! I'm trying to put you in bondage! And I'm like, you people don't make any sense at all. And I used to be one of you. I don't get it. Yeah. And so they were kicked out of the garden. And part of that, I believe, was an act of mercy. Why? Why was it an act of mercy? So they couldn't live forever in a fallen state. It says right there, open book test, right? Lest they reach and take from the tree of life also, then they would have been living in an eternal fallen state. So it was a gift, really, of mercy to take us out of there. But there's also a principle we see later on in Scripture that this is not the land of the Jews. It's not the land of Israel. It's God's land. It's Yahuwah's land. He's the landlord, and he has house rules. You know, I've lived in apartments, right? You got to sign all these pages. You got to read all these pages, all these house rules, right? What happens if you live in an apartment and you sign all that, and then you violate those commandments of your landlord? You get evicted. Well, it's the same with that land. Leviticus 18 says, look, you know, here are the house rules. If you violate them, the land's going to vomit you out. That's a pretty picture, huh? Where does it vomit you? Well, in the case of the Garden of Eden, it says they were vomited to the east, to Babylon. So what is Babylon? Well, you look this up, the word Babylon comes up 265 times in a keyword search of the King James Bible, or 273 times in the New American Standard Bible. Even just a cursory glance over the various references reveals that Babylon is not a good place in which to be. It is associated with captivity and evil. In the post-flood world, it is the place where Nimrod built a tower with the goal of, quote-unquote, reaching into heaven, ... in order to kill Yahuwah. Now, we don't get that in Genesis chapter 11. We just see that they're trying to build this thing, and, you know, God looks and sees what they're doing. But when you look in some of the, what I call, biblically endorsed extra-biblical texts, or shall I say synchronized biblically endorsed extra-biblical texts, and when I use that phrase, I'm saying synchronized because books like Enoch, Joshua, and Jubilees in particular, who clearly the authors of Scripture were familiar with, I mean, they're quoting from these books, they're referencing them by name, they talk about things that can't be found anywhere else except in those books. So I'm like, well, okay, if the Holy Spirit-inspired authors of Scripture can read these books, maybe I can too. So I started looking into them. And in Joshua, it goes into a lot more detail about what their plans were with the Tower of Babel. And basically, there were three camps that were divided up under the leadership of Nimrod. And one camp, their goal was to get into heaven and take out the angels. Another group was going to go in then and take over the throne room and kill God. And then the other group was going to go in there and set Nimrod up and their gods up in the Holy of Holies of heaven. That's a pretty crazy objective. But what's interesting is that when God looks down and sees what they're doing, he says, now nothing will be restrained from them which they have imagined to do. That's an extraordinary statement. Now, I don't think it's possible for them to kill God, but for them to actually get into heaven seems to be what's going on here. And God's like, hey, if they keep doing what they're doing, it's possible. Now, some of you know of some of my other research. And I don't know if you've heard of this, if everybody here has heard of Andrew Hoy and his research. If you haven't, Andrew Hoy has a completely different take on the tabernacle in the wilderness. He is a structural engineer and a Hebrew scholar. And he was in Israel studying the tabernacle. And can we just add whatever we want to the Torah? Oh, it comes with a specific command not to, right? You can't add to it, and you can't subtract from it. So Andrew, as a structural engineer, is looking at all the various models that you can see, you know, replicas, life-size versions of the tabernacle and stuff, in the land of Israel and elsewhere, where people have built these things. And he's looking at these in there. You know, most of them are pretty close to the same with some variations, but in every case, he was seeing where they were adding tent pegs and rope or extra beams and whatnot. Because as a structural engineer, he's looking at this box and going, well, that's about the least structurally sound thing you could build. And, of course, recognizing that, people are having to fortify it with other things adding to the text to make the thing stand upright. And Andrew's trying to be a biblical literalist, and he's looking at the text, you know, in Hebrew and in English, and he's going, well, if they're adding... Moses was given an itemized shopping list, wasn't he? He was shown something in heaven that he was to emulate here on earth. What is earth... How is earth referred to in the scripture? As God's what? Footstool. And in Isaiah 40:22, the heavens are stretched out like a tent. Right, over us. Well, I don't know about your world. In my world, tents are stretched out over flat surfaces. Call me crazy, but all the tents I've ever seen are like that. And certainly the tents in the days of Isaiah were like that. So he's looking at this stuff, and he's like, well, why did people come up with this rectangular box? And he became obsessed with the text that describes the curtains. And if you go and read the description of the tabernacle, there's a lot of textual real estate used up for the curtains. A lot of time is taken into the description of the curtains, whereas some of the other stuff doesn't have that much description. So he's like, okay, well, clearly the curtains are important to God, and it says to connect the curtains at the ends. Doesn't tell you which end. And the way the curtains are described, the assumption is you connect them at the long ends. When you do, you essentially end up with a rectangular box. And he's like, well, nothing in the text demands that, so what if I connected them at the short ends? And when he did that, he ended up with a 6-story high circular dome tent in the wilderness. This is totally and completely apart from anything to do whatsoever with flat earth. You could have to ask him if he's a flat earther. That was not his thing. Just looking at it as a structural engineer, a biblical literalist, not adding or subtracting from the Torah, and as a Hebrew scholar, this is what he came up with. Coincidentally, at the same exact time, I came up with this model. And, you know, he writes, he found out about me as a result of doing some Google searches. And he's looking at my model, and he's looking at his model. He's like, I think you're going to need to talk to this guy. So he contacts me. We've had some extremely interesting conversations ever since. And if you've seen my previous lectures and stuff, specifically talking about the Tower of Babel, you know that I always said it was not about height, right? And that's because I had the spinning heliocentric globular earth and an ever-expanding universe mindset, which nobody in the Bible had. And so I thought, well, you know, it's in the plains of Shinar, so if you're trying to really get to heaven, you start on a mountain. I used to say all this stuff, you know. And then I'm going, wait a minute, if they had this cosmological worldview, then what they're doing makes perfect sense. So I went back to those synchronized biblically endorsed extra-biblical texts and started looking into it again, and Joshua Jubilees gives you a whole lot of detail that I just read over and wasn't really paying attention to as to how big this thing was. And other archaeological finds have suggested that the base of this thing may have been as big as 200 square miles or bigger. Well, now it starts to make sense. That's why they built it in the plains of Shinar. You need a big enough space to build a large enough foundation to build a big enough building to reach the top of the dome. So I'm going, well, okay. You know, whatever the case may be, what they were attempting, God said, now whatever they imagined to do would not be restrained from them. So what happened next? He confounds their language, right? And Babel, part of Babylon, and the name Babel deals with the confusion of the languages. And we see that that's the place, a number of places in Scripture where we see that they, due to disobedience, were carried off to Babylon, such as 2 Kings 20:17, Ezra 5:12, and elsewhere. The Jews spent 70 years there in captivity. Then finally, they came out of Babylon. I believe it is time for us to do the same. Why? Because unfortunately, the Jews carried Babylon with them when they left. They brought back many pagan customs, beliefs, and practices from their time there, just as they did when they left Egypt. Those things, customs, ideas, and practices became intermingled with the true faith of Yahuwah, and it always got them into trouble. Those traditions brought forth from Babylon were the primary cause of many of the issues that Yeshua had to deal with when confronting the Pharisees and Sadducees of his day. Now the church of Yeshua has basically gone and done the same thing. Many of the traditions and practices of the church today are rooted in pagan Babylon. I think many of you already recognize that, otherwise you probably wouldn't be here. You'd be getting ready for your Easter ham tomorrow. Yeah. But the call of the last days is to come out of Babylon. And that's my first book up there, Babylon Rising and the First Shall Be Last. And there was a chapter that I titled Coming Out of Babylon. And that dealt primarily with geopolitical issues of, our troops leaving Iraq and things of that nature. And I thought, okay, I'm done with the book, cool. And I got the tap on my shoulder. You got to come out of Babylon too. I'm not in Babylon. I left the army in 1993. Never had to go. Yeah, no, that's not what I'm talking about. And I'd already done all this research on Nimrod and had already put the pieces together about Christmas and Easter and all that, and then realized, wow, we have truly inherited lies. So many things that we do in the Christian church is rooted in paganism. In fact, George Barna put out a book called Pagan Christianity, and he comes right out and tells you, it's like, pretty much if we're doing it, it's not in the Bible. I'm paraphrasing, of course. But he goes through a long list of things that are regular practices in your typical evangelical Sunday church that just were not practiced by the people who were following the way in the first century. So, we need to come out of Babylon, and I believe actually Abraham is the one that leads the way. I put parenthetically, back. Back where? Well, let's continue. There's a timeline chart that I created. I'm a visual person, so it helps me to put things down in visual format so I can really see what's going on there. And when I put this timeline chart together, as a result of reading through Joshua and seeing there's a ton of information of basically this war between Abraham and Nimrod. It's quite extraordinary. And there's a whole lot of detail I don't have time to cover in this presentation here, but let's just go cut to the chase. And why Abraham? Why did God choose Abram? Why did he choose him in the first place? Well, Nimrod was in the land of Shinar, and he had essentially been made the king of the world in 1948 AM. AM is year since creation. That might give you a little clue as to what was going on in 1948 AD. 1948. This was the same year that Abram was born. Now, a lot of people will say, yeah, Abram was born in 1948, and the nation state of Israel was born in 1948. I'm going, hey, yeah, but they put themselves under the star of Remphan, and they like did this whole thing with the Rothschilds and the Zionists and the Freemasons. And let's go through Jeremiah 23, Jeremiah 30, Jeremiah 31, Ezekiel 37, the entire book of Hosea, Isaiah 65 and 66. Let's go through it line by line, shall we? Tell me which one of those things happened in 1948. I came to the conclusion none of them did. Especially when you, what can a nation be born in a day? Yep, May 14th, 1948. Isaiah 66:8. Okay, read four verses later. Peace will flow like a river from that place. Have we had peace since 1948? Must be still waiting on that, I guess. Well, let's go back prior to that. Oh, that's when somebody dies at 100 and he's considered a child. That's when the wolf is lying down with the lamb. Read the entire chapter 65, then go into chapter 66, and you realize the whole thing's in a millennial reign context. I submit that 1948 is a counterfeit, and it's based on the individual that was made king of the world at that same year. Just my opinion. Nimrod's evil kingship was a big part of the reason why Yahuwah called Abram out of Ur of the Chaldees, just south of Babylon, in the first place. We read in Genesis chapter 11, Terah took Abram his son and Lot, the son of Haran, his son's son, and Sarai his daughter-in-law, his son Abram's wife, and they went forth with them from Ur of the Chaldees to go into the land of Canaan, and they came unto Haran and dwelt there. Why Haran? What was going on there? Well, the patron god of Ur was a god named Sin. Sin was the god of the moon in the Mesopotamian mythology of Akkad, Assyria, and Babylonia. Nana is a Sumerian deity, and the son of Enlil and Ninlil, and became identified with the Semitic Sin. The two chief seats of Nana's sin worship were Ur in the south of Mesopotamia and Haran in the north. So basically, if you read the Joshua, Terah and Nimrod and Abram, there's some real tension going on there. So they think, okay, we got to get out of Ur. Well, Terah was an idol worshiper. We see that in Scripture, and we see it also detailed for us in the book of Joshua. We see in Joshua 24 that they served other gods, right? Even Terah. And we see in Joshua 9, 7, 8, it goes into a lot of detail. He was like the chief idol maker. I mean, he was like, that's his thing. But now he's having trouble in his hometown there. And so all he did is pick up shop and go to the next place where his goods would be welcome. They went to Haran. And God's like, hello, McFly. Told you, Canaan, you know, get out of there. Abram, you need to leave your father's house. Go to the place that I'll show you. I mean, he just basically gave him marching orders and said, you know, I'll stop you when you get there. So we see that Abram goes on his journey and he travels through the land and he's stopped in Shechem. And I'm going, okay, why Shechem? What in the world is the deal with Shechem? Again, I'm a visual person. I saw a map like this that showed the journey that Abram took, and he is stopped in Shechem. And basically God's like, okay, man, take a look around. Everything, that's yours. This is where I want you to set up shop. And again, we don't have time to go through it in this presentation. I covered in a lot more detail in the Yahuwah Triangle series. Just do a keyword search in your Bible of Shechem and read about all the things that happened in this one location. It's amazing. And so I began to realize there's something significant about this very specific location. And if you look at it on Google Earth, that's what you see. It looks like it was at one time maybe one mountain range that somebody just scooped out the middle of it and, you know, left it basically this amphitheater. It was a natural amphitheater in between Mount Gerizim and Mount Ebal. So I began to speculate. You know, I already thought that the land that we call Israel was the Garden of Eden. And I began to speculate, okay, Abram is stopped right in this very specific location. Maybe that has something to do with the Garden of Eden also. And then I see this scripture in Hosea also linking Adam in the garden with Shechem. And we might need somebody on the soundboard there in case this, I'm going to play a video here by Jim Staley. It might be loud. Okay, so I'm thinking about all these things, kind of formulating ideas in my head. And I walked through the kitchen and Sheila was doing something and she was listening to a teaching that Jim Staley was doing on the Torah portion, Re'ah. And right when I walked out, Jim Staley is saying what I'm about to play here, which was some amazing revelation that he got regarding Shechem and Abraham.
If you go to Deuteronomy chapter 27, it says this, "Then Moses and the elders of Israel charged the people, saying, keep all the commandments which I command you today." So here it is. "So it shall be on the day when you cross the Jordan into the land which the Lord God gives you that day, that you shall set up for yourself large stones and coat them with lime, and write on them all the words of this law," okay, and that word law is Torah, okay, "write on the words of this law," the Torah, which means instructions, "when you cross over, so that you may enter the land which the Lord God gives you, a land flowing with milk and honey, as the Lord the God of your fathers promised you. So it shall be when you cross the Jordan, you shall set up on Mount Ebal these stones, as I'm commanding you today, and you shall coat them with lime." Mount Gerizim, Mount Ebal, right there in the center is the city of ancient Shechem. Okay? This is a narrow passageway. And for the sake of time, I'm just going to tell you the story. What Yahweh said is, he said, "I want you to go in, I want you to take the Ark of the Covenant, I want you to take half the tribes, and I want you to stand on half of them on Mount Gerizim, and I want you to take the other half of the tribes, and I want you to stand on Mount Ebal." And he says, "I want you to proclaim the blessings. While I'm proclaiming the blessings, I want you everyone to look to Mount Gerizim. And when you proclaim the curses, I want everyone to look at Mount Ebal." Right in the middle between Mount Ebal and Mount Gerizim is a natural amphitheater. It's absolutely phenomenal. It's a natural amphitheater. It's a natural like valley. It's kind of off in the distance where the horizon is there. And that's where they stood, right in the valley, so everybody could hear, all however many there were. couple of million people. This is Joshua's altar. This was a spectacular, gorgeous altar. Right here between these two mountains is a derrick at Shechem where God's people were there. And on one side was the blessings, one side was the curses. He's using visuals to get his point across. Joshua builds an altar, uses natural stones. The limestone is put around it for a reason, because limestone is malleable. Limestone you can write on. You understand what I'm saying? It's a soft stone. You can only write on something that's soft. And he wants to write it on a heart of flesh, vellum. Limestone. And he says, I want my Torah to be written on your heart. They departed and they went to the land of Canaan. So they came to the land of Canaan, the same exact route as the Israelites are at right now. Abram passed through the land of the place of Shechem, I just showed you that, as far as the terebinth tree of Moreh. There it is. So this is the very first time that we have someone stopping at the tree of Moreh. What happens? The Canaanites were then in the land. Then the Lord appeared to Abram and said, to your descendants I will give this land. And there he built an altar to Yahweh who had appeared to him. Are you kidding me? This is 400 years, ladies and gentlemen, before Joshua shows up with the Israelites in this exact same place. Now see, we don't live in the land, so we don't make these connections. But Abraham, What was the covenant made from? What happened that day? Did he give him a can of Pepsi and say, drink, let's pray, you know. What's that? No? What happened that day? Something was cut in two. An animal was cut in two, remember? And two halves, and what happened? Abraham was put to sleep. And he went through the middle, did he not? Right here, ladies and gentlemen, there's a reason that Mount Ebal and Mount Gerizim are standing the way that they are, because they are standing as a witness. 400 years later, the altar that Abraham made and the picture. Why do you think that he had half the tribes go on one side and half the tribes go on the other? And the tabernacle, the temple, the Ark of the Covenant is right dead center in between. Because this is the exact place where Yahweh walked between the two halves.
All right. I thought that was really cool, because I had seen that in two places in the book of Psalms, it talks about God dividing Shechem. So what did I say before? It's like you have this mountain range that looks like it's been cut out. You know, like maybe somebody went through it, cut it, maybe did like a figure eight between some animal parts or something. Why in that location? It's my opinion, and it's just my opinion, that I think that's the original location of the two trees. I believe that that's where the first animal was killed. Because Adam and Eve, after they sinned, right, they're like, hey, we're naked, and God had to kill an animal and clothe them, right? That's where fellowship was broken. And when God finally finds somebody that he can work with, Abram, we don't have time to get into the story, but it's kind of a pretty cool story about what Abram did with his father's idols and all that. I think God looked at what Abram was doing and is like, yeah, I can work with this guy, you know. And he calls Abram out and brings him to that exact spot. And then later he cuts a covenant with Abram in that exact spot. And then after the Israelites wander through the wilderness for 40 years and they are allowed to finally come into land, God specifically tells them to go to this exact spot and to divide and put half the tribes on Gerizim and half on Ebal. And the ones on Gerizim are pronouncing the blessings, and the ones on Ebal are pronouncing the curses, and they're to put the law, build the altar, write it all out on there, because I believe that's where the tree of the knowledge of good and evil was, where they screwed up the first time. And it's like, okay, you know, let's put something here so we can remember, so we can stay here this time. Again, just theory, just speculation on my part. But we see that that's what they're told to do in Deuteronomy 11. You know, this is where they're supposed to go in there and divide up. And put half on one mountain and the other half on the other. And in Deuteronomy 30, when it comes to the commandments, this has always struck me as rather interesting, because in standard Christianity, we're basically told what? Are we able to keep the commandments or not? Oh, it's impossible! We can't do it! I'm like, then, you know, what do we do with Moses? I mean, what was he on crack? What? I mean, Moses, he's like, for this commandment which I commanded thee this day, it is not hidden from thee, neither is it afar off. It is not in heaven that thou shouldest say, who's going to go up to heaven and bring it down for us so we can hear it and do it? Neither is it beyond the sea that thou shouldest say, who shall go over the sea for us and bring it unto us, and we shall hear it and do it? Is that not what most Christians are teaching us? I believed it. It's impossible. Well, he's telling you it's not too far. It's near to you. You can do it. I've set before you this day life and good and death and evil. And I command thee this day to love the Lord thy God, to walk in his ways, to keep his commandments and his statutes and his judgments, that thou mayest live and multiply. And the Lord thy God shall bless thee in the land whither thou goest to possess it. And he says, but if thine heart turn away so that thou wilt not hear, but shall be drawn away and worship other gods and serve them, I denounce unto you this day that ye shall surely perish, and that ye shall not prolong your days upon the land, whither thou passest over the Jordan to go to possess it. I call heaven and earth to record this day against you, that I have set before you life and death, blessing and cursing. Therefore, choose life, that both thou and thy seed may live, that thou mayest love the Lord thy God. What's the two commandments? Right? Jesus gave us two commandments only, right? Supposedly. Love God, love your neighbor. Well, we get the love your neighbor part, but what does it mean to love God? It tells you all through the Bible. If your Bible doesn't just start with Matthew or Galatians, you read the whole thing, it tells you what it means to love God. Here's one of the examples right here. That thou mayest obey his voice, and that thou mayest cleave unto him, for he is thy life, and the length of thy days, that thou mayest dwell in the land which the Lord sware unto thy fathers, to Abraham, to Isaac, and to Jacob, to give them. Some of this terminology looks awfully familiar to me when I looked at Genesis 2, verse 9 and 15 through 17. And out of the ground made the Lord God to grow every tree that is pleasant to the sight and good for food, the tree of life also in the midst of the garden, and the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. Verse 15, and the Lord God took the man and put him in the garden of Eden to dress it and to keep it. And the Lord God commanded the man, saying, of every tree of the garden thou mayest freely eat, but of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil thou shalt not eat of it. For in the day that thou eatest thereof, thou shalt surely die. They're given a choice between life and death. Right there. They chose death. And then later you see them going back to, I believe, the exact same location. And it's like Moses is now saying, look, I'm calling heaven and earth together as a witness right here. And I've set before you life and death, blessing and cursing. Therefore, choose life. Like, hello, McFly. Let's get this one right this time. Choose life. It is my firm belief. And again, it's just speculation, but it's my belief based on this research, that Abram was led out of sin to Shechem, and that Yahuwah made his covenant promise there, and that the Israelites, upon entering the land, had to first stop there, write out the commandments, and pronounce the blessings and curses, because this is ground zero in the Garden of Eden. And he wants to call us back there, too. This leads us into the primary thesis. That was all a build-up for the story about how he redeemed his bride. Hosea is an amazing book. But when I was in standard evangelical, I would say parenthetically, pagan Christianity, that was one of those books, Hosea, you know. I didn't pay much attention to that. So I went through a divorce, a painful divorce. My wife of 7 years, went away on a 6-day business trip. I came back from this business trip to find an empty house, let her divorce, and discovered my wife was out sleeping with some guy up in Maine. Just totally rocked my world, like unlike anything else. And it was a very rough season. And during that season, for whatever reason, God kept putting homeless people in my path. And, you know, at that time I was broke. I was going through bankruptcy, just all kinds of big mess. It's part of what led to the divorce. And I finally got this job where I was making some pretty decent money and getting my feet back on the ground again. And my boss said, hey, can you mail some packages for me? I said, sure. He gave me the van. I took the van to the post office. And I see this homeless guy sitting on the side there. And I had just gotten paid. It's been the first time I had a check in a long time. And I felt like God was saying, give it to him. I'm like, Hello? Have you not been paying attention to the last few months? Give it to him. I said, okay. So you know how we sometimes bargain with God? I'm like, okay, here's the deal, right? Here's the deal. I'm going to go in because I don't want to just enable somebody. If this guy's just going to take it and spend it on drugs or alcohol or waste it or whatever, you know, I need this cash for some legitimate needs, right? If he's just going to squander it, you know, I said, I'm going to walk in, I'm going to do the thing in the post office there, and if he really legitimately needs this money, then let him still be there when I come out. If he's just going to waste it, then, you know, have him walk away or something. Okay, so I go in there, and I'm kind of thinking, I hope he's a drug addict. I hope he's, you know, whatever. You know, like, I haven't paid in a long time. I'm broke. So I come out, and the dude's still sitting there. I'm like, I said, all right. So it was a really hot day. I said, hey, man, come on in the van. Don't worry, I'm not crazy or anything. Just have a seat here. It's air conditioned. So, you know, he comes to the van, and I said, hey, listen, I feel like I'm supposed to help you, but I want to know your story. Why are you in this situation? What's your deal? And he proceeds to tell me my story. Everything that he was going through was exactly what I was going through. And so I start crying, and he's like, what's the matter? I said, dude, you're where I'm about to be. And he goes, you need to read the book of Hosea. What? I mean, that's like Habakkuk, right? I mean, who reads that? Right? I'm a New Testament Bible-believing Christian. Hosea. This dude goes on to preach to me for probably another half hour. And I'm like, man. So I said, he's like, can I pray for you? I'm like, I always think I got to pray for you, but yeah, okay. So, you know, he prayed with me, and, you know, we prayed together, lots of tears and stuff. And anyway, I gave him the money. And this is one of those deals where, you know, he left, and as soon as he got out of the van, I just said one of those quick prayers, like, wow, God, you know, I needed that more than he did. Thank you. You know, that's about as much as I said. And I look out, and he's gone. I'm thinking, okay, was this one of those angels unaware kind of thing, you know? Turns out it wasn't. He contacted me quite some time later. We exchanged contact information. Anyway, he just wanted to tell me what that seed had done for him, that he had went on to start a homeless ministry and helped other people. And part of what I gave him helped him get on his feet to enable him to do that. And I tell you this story for another reason. I believe we reap what we sow. In that season when God was putting homeless people in front of me, it was really because I was about to become homeless, which I did. And people came and helped me the same way that I ended up helping the people that I saw. So it was like a big test, you know. And I'm just going to suggest to you that if you get those promptings in your spirit, you see that person on the side of the road or whatever, go with it. There are some divine appointments awaiting you, I think. I did read the book of Hosea back then, but I was in way too much pain to receive anything from it. You know, I'm reading now, I'm like, yeah, whore. You know, I'm just like, yeah, that's right, you know, whatever. Yeah, okay. I wasn't getting the point. This is back in 2002, mind you. Flash forward about 12 years later, 2014, and God, you know, I need to show you what that triangle thing's about, and you need to read the book of Hosea. Okay. Went back to read the book of Hosea with the Torah understanding and the Ephraim understanding and all the things that we're talking about here this weekend that I did not have before. And wow, that is a powerful book. Hosea 1. When the Lord first began speaking to Israel through Hosea, he said to him, go and marry a prostitute so that some of her children will be conceived in prostitution. This will illustrate how Israel has acted like a prostitute by turning against the Lord and worshiping other gods. Wow, that poor dude. What he had to go through. Continuing in chapter 1. It says, yet the time will come when Israel's people will be like the sands of the seashore, too many to count. Then at the place where they were told, you are not my people, it will be said, you are children of the living God. Then the people of Judah and Israel will unite together. How many do you see there? One or two? Two. Judah and Israel. Interesting. Will unite together. They will choose one leader for themselves, and they will return from exile together. What a day that will be, the day of Jezreel, when God will again plant his people in his land. What I'm about to go into, the rest of this presentation, really, I got to give credit where credit is due, largely came as a result of seeing this video right here by Jim Staley, Identity Crisis. How many of you have seen this film? Man, it is a powerful film. Unfortunately, it's hard to find these days. You know, we need to pray for Jim. You know, he's gone through some things and he's reaping for it. But you know what? That man has impacted countless numbers of people's lives. And this video just was so... there. I had a lot of pieces of the puzzle that I thought I understood and I thought I had maybe in the right place. This was like him taking the, you know, maybe it's a 5,000-piece puzzle, and he dumped about 4,500 pieces just, and they fell into place. I'm going, whoa, I don't have the whole picture, but I got a lot more of it than I had before. This is amazing, and it's hard to find this video online now because somebody, whoever you are out there listening, I hope, keeps taking them down. That's wrong. It's on YouTube, but it's not on YouTube for long. Because every time somebody puts it on YouTube, somebody keeps taking it down. And I think that's a mistake. Because many people still need to hear this message. Whatever you may think of Jim Staley, the message is sound. You know, personally, I love the guy. Pray for him. And he's having a whole new ministry, I think, in prison right now. Obviously there for probably more than one reason, I'm going to suggest. This is a phenomenal video. Highly suggest if you can find it, check it out. Maybe you'll be able to find it on DVD somewhere. Then I would say, probably for many of you, maybe not many of you here in this room, but many of you that may be watching this online, The Era of Dispensationalism by 119 Ministries would be the next one to watch. I was a hardcore dispensationalist, hardcore preacher rapture dispensationalist, until I realized how completely unbiblical that whole thing is. And 119 Ministries did a really good job, in my opinion, of unpacking that whole thing and showing the errors of dispensationalism. And with that foundation, having watched those two videos, I was in a hurry. I'm a geek Star Trek fan and all that. And one of the Star Trek movies had come out. I'm like, ooh, I got to go see it. And I looked at the clock. It was like, I got 10 minutes. Cool. I ran down the stairs, missed the last one, broke my foot. Snapped in like three places, had to crawl back up the stairs. Busted my foot, had to go get that fixed. And as a result, I couldn't attend my Shabbat service, you know, that weekend. And so I was just laying there in bed, and I'm like, well, you know, and I had, you know, I was on pain medicine and everything. I'm like, well, I'm going to see if I can find something. I wonder what 119 has. You know, so I went, and I think this was a new teaching. If not, it was certainly new for me. They had put up this teaching called Nailed to the Cross. And I don't know if it was the pain meds or what, but if I thought I cried like a baby with Identity Crisis, I was unstoppable when I saw it Nailed to the Cross. Unbelievable. Now, I always wondered, you know, okay, I get it, Yeshua had to die for our sins, but why crucifixion? Why did it have to be that specific form of execution? Why did it have to last as long as it did? And Steve Mutria does an amazing job of describing the cup of bitter waters, right? The woman that is suspected of being caught in adultery, the husband has the right to have her drink this stuff, and if she's guilty, it causes her stomach to swell and her thighs to rot, right? It causes lots of problems for her. If she's innocent, nothing happens to her. That guy's in a lot of trouble, probably afterwards, the guy that made her do it. But Yeshua, when he's in the garden, he's praying for this cup to pass from me. Now, I've written, directed, and played Jesus in passion plays and have played the part in the garden and all that. And I always just looked at, you know, let this cup pass from me and that whole thing as, you know, this metaphor for the pain that he's about to endure, you know. And yes, that's certainly true. But how much was he purchased for? What was he betrayed for? How many pieces of silver? 30 pieces of silver. What's the significance of that? That's the price of a woman. When you look at the value that is given, you know, in various places in the Torah, he was purchased for the price of a woman. 30 pieces of silver. And when I come to understand what Jim and these guys were talking about, I'm like, wow, he literally became the adulterous woman. And he was about to drink the cup, metaphorically speaking, but he was about to suffer the exact same consequences. Because when you're hanging on the cross, that's exactly what ends up happening to you. You have to just to breathe, every breath you take, every breath, just sit here and just breathe for a few seconds and count how many times you would have to push yourself up on the spikes going through your feet just to exhale. Just having the spikes through your hands and feet is brutal enough. Never mind all the whipping and beating he took. I think Mel Gibson came close to showing what really happened, how horrific it was. Not only does he have the pain of all the whipping and scourging, all that he went through, and the spikes in his hands and feet and the crown of thorns, but just to breathe, he has to push up on those spikes every time to exhale. A person dies of suffocation over an extended period of time. Sometimes somebody can, depending on how strong they are, can last days in that condition. It's part of the reason why the thieves had to have their legs broken, so that they would suffocate, because they could no longer push themselves up. So literally, I mean, just take the time, put your one foot over the other, and do that up and down motion. Anybody ever have a Charlie horse before? Imagine a 6-hour Charlie horse, growing exponentially worse with every breath you take, on top of the pain of the spikes, and the crown of thorns, and the scourging. His belly extended, it swelled, his thighs rotted, and he died of a broken heart. Paying the price that we deserved. Unbelievable. The love that he had to do that for us. You know, I look at Hosea, he's like, tells this guy, go marry a prostitute so you know what I'm going through. You know why God hates divorce? Because he's been through it. What are you talking about, Rob? Well, Scripture tells us that God was divorced. Jeremiah chapter 3. And I saw, when for all the causes whereby backsliding Israel committed adultery, I had put her away and given her a bill of divorce. Yet her treacherous sister Judah feared not, but went and played the harlot also. God divorced Israel. And he would have done the same to Judah had he not made promises that had to be fulfilled through Judah. He still had to bring the Messiah through Judah. So he had to put up with whoring Judah also. But he divorced the northern kingdom. All of a sudden, when I started to understand this, and understand this Judah and Israel, this two, the northern kingdom, the southern kingdom, and all of that, and you see that Yeshua is there in Judea talking to Jews, and he says, I was sent only to the lost sheep of the house of Israel. Whoa, wait a minute. Only to the lost sheep of the house of Israel. Question. If, as most of us have been taught, the church, quote unquote, didn't show up until 50 days after the resurrection at Pentecost of Acts 2, how then can this scripture make sense? Ephesians 5:25. Husband, love your wives, even as Christ also loved the church and gave himself for it. Do you see the problem? If the church didn't exist until Pentecost of Acts 2, who is he in love with and who is he sacrificing himself for? Do you see the problem? The church has already existed. Stephen tells you the church in the wilderness. That's why I said last night, you know, yes, the church began at Pentecost, but just not the one in Acts 2. He loved the church that Stephen said was in the wilderness so much that he gave himself for her. Redeeming the bride. Deuteronomy 24 gives us an interesting law, verses 1 through 4. When a man hath taken a wife and married her, and it come to pass that she find no favor in his eyes, because he hath found some uncleanness in her, then let him write her a bill of divorcement, and give it to her into her hand, and send her out of his house. And when she is departed out of his house, she may go and be another man's wife. And if the latter husband hate her, and write her a bill of divorcement, and giveth it in her hand, and sendeth her out of his house, or if the latter husband die, which took her to be his wife, her former husband, the first husband, which sent her away, may not take her again to be his wife after that she is defiled, for that is an abomination before the Lord. And thou shalt not cause the land to sin, which the Lord thy God giveth thee for an inheritance. So suddenly we have a big problem here. We see that he's liking Israel as a whore, committing adultery. He writes a divorce. The law says that if he divorces her and she's with somebody else, well, he divorced her because she is with somebody else, that his own law says he can never take her back. And yet, in the same book, Hosea, he says, I'm going to win her back. Again, can you not see the angels in heaven going, who's going to tell him? He made this rule back in Deuteronomy. You know, I ain't telling him, you tell him, I ain't telling him. Let's just wait and see what happens. Right? The only way the husband could take back the bride he had divorced without breaking his own law, Deuteronomy 24, would be to die for her. I believe this is the great mystery that Paul figured out concerning the church. When Paul talks about the mystery of the church, and people in the Hebrew Roots movement want to throw Paul out, I'm like, what are you doing? He's the guy that gets it. He was a Torah scholar. He gives us his pedigree, right? He tells us his background, his history. I'm a Pharisee of Pharisees of the tribe of Benjamin. Right? He studied under Gamaliel. And then I started studying Torah and understanding how the education system was structured. Did you know that young children, as young as age 5, begin memorizing the Torah, and they start with Leviticus? They don't start in Genesis, they start in Leviticus. Because Leviticus is the book that tells you how to approach a holy God. So they start the kids off with that, and then they say, okay, when you kind of get that, let's go back to Genesis and work your way forward. And the education system throughout the various grades, if you will, of education as they grow older, is to test their aptitude. How well are they picking this up? How much of the Torah can you memorize? If you were able to memorize the whole thing, you go on to become a disciple in higher education of a rabbi. You know? And Paul is telling you that he was studied under Gamaliel, who was like the big guy. You know, he would be the guy that everybody would want. Wow, you know, he was your rabbi? And Yeshua was interesting because if you didn't have the aptitude to memorize the Torah, well, there's no sense in going any further. You just don't have the aptitude. So then you go off into a trade. And so here's Yeshua picking a bunch of guys who apparently didn't have the aptitude because they were all tradesmen, weren't they? Fishermen, farmers, tax collectors, and whatnot. Yeah. I mean, talk about humility. You think Yeshua was a little bit better than Gamaliel? I think he was a lot better. He's teaching them when he's 12. Right? And yet, instead of him picking the top people to be his super disciples to show off, he picks what would have been considered the low lives of society to be his guys. Paul, on the other hand, he studied all that stuff. He's in the system, right? He's spotted by this guy, Gamaliel. He becomes a disciple of Gamaliel, and he brags about it. And later he considers it all dung. You know, but he was for a specific time. After Yeshua had already left, you know, and Paul is zealous, he thinks he's doing the right thing. He's killing these pagan Christians that he thinks that are violators of this, that, and the other thing. He thinks he's doing the right thing. He's got so much zeal, but it was misplaced, misunderstood zeal. So God had to knock him off his horse, blind him for a little while, humble him. And then he put Paul back together again. And with all of that education that Paul had, and spending time, I believe, with Yeshua alone, being tutored by Yeshua, he ends up writing 2/3 of this thing we call the New Testament. And explains all of this. I'm like, don't throw Paul out. Man! He gets it. He understands this stuff. He talks about in 1 Corinthians 7:39, the wife is bound by the law as long as her husband lives. But if her husband is dead, she is at liberty to be married to whom she will, only in the Lord. What law is he talking about, 1 Corinthians? Well, let's back up to Romans. Romans chapter 7. Know ye not, brethren, for I speak to them that know the law. So he's a highly educated guy, has the law memorized. And he's saying, those of you who are familiar with it, listen up. I'm talking to you. How that the law hath dominion over a man as long as he liveth? For the woman which hath an husband is bound by the law to her husband as long as he liveth. But if the husband be dead, she is loosed from what law? The law of her husband. Not the whole Torah. The specific law in the Torah. He's saying, those of you who understand this, they would pick up on this. So then, if while her husband liveth, she be married to another man, she shall be called an adulteress. But if her husband be dead, she is free from that law, so that she is no adulteress, though she be married to another man. Wherefore, my brethren, ye also are become dead to the law. Which law? That law. By the body of Christ, that you should be married to another, even to him who is raised from the dead, that we should bring forth fruit unto God. That's King James. I think the Holman Christian Standard Bible words that a little easier to understand. It says, therefore, my brothers, you also were put to death in relation to the law through the crucified body of the Messiah, so that you may belong to another, to him who was raised from the dead, that you may bear fruit for God. We look in Hosea chapter 2, 17 through 20. O Israel, I will wipe the names of Baal from your lips, and you will never mention them again. I'm not dogmatic about this either. I know the people in the sacred name movement, you'll get all wrapped around the axle about some of this stuff. But God has a name. Now, whether we choose to pronounce it Jehovah, Yehovah, Yahuwah, Yahweh, he has a name, Yod-Heh-Vav-Heh. His name is not God. His name is not the Lord. And when you see how much he wants his name to be known over and over and over again, I want my name to be known. I want my name to be known. Not changed into a title over 6,000 times. The word Baal means Lord. So why would I want to, I understand that Lord can have all kinds of meaning. Adonai means Lord too, but the text in so many places, over 6,000 places in your Bible, says Yod-Heh-Vav-Heh. And yet, our translators decided to put the word Lord in there. So when I know that Baal means Lord, and I know that his name is not the Lord, I'm looking at this going, well, this is interesting. He says, I'm going to wipe the names of the Baals from your lips. You'll never mention them again. And he says, on that day I will make a covenant with all the wild animals and the birds of the sky, and the animals that scurry along the ground, so they will not harm you. I will remove all weapons of war from the land. Has this happened yet? Huh. I'm going to remove all weapons of war from the land, all swords and bows, so you can live unafraid in peace and safety. Not begging for money for every conflict that they want to do over there, sending our young men and women to have their arms and legs blown off and have people killed over a counterfeit. He says, look, when I do it, this is what's going to happen. The reason there's constant strife over there is because it wasn't done the way he said it's going to happen. And he says, at that time, I will make you my wife forever, showing you righteousness and justice, unfailing love and compassion. I will be faithful to you and make you mine, and you will finally know me, not as the Lord, as Yod-Heh-Vav-Heh. What are the Baals? Well, in my mythology to become a great deception research and the Babylon Rising research, I found ultimately the various depictions you see up there funnel right into an individual known as Nimrod, the lawless one, the rebellious one. He's going to wipe all that from your lips. Hosea 2, 22 and 23. Then the earth will answer the thirsty cries of the grain, the grapevines and the olive trees, and they in turn will answer, Jezreel, God plants. At that time, I will plant a crop of, who's going to do it? Who's going to do it? Who's going to plant it? Okay, so it's not the Zionists, the Rothschilds, the Freemasons, none of those guys, the United Nations. Okay, just check it. At that time, I will plant a crop of Israelites and raise them for myself. I will show love to those I called not loved, and to those I called not my people, I will say, now you are my people. And they will reply, you are my God. Romans 11. For I would not, brethren, that you should be ignorant of this mystery, lest you should be wise in your own conceits, that blindness in part has happened to Israel until the fullness of the Gentiles be come in. And so all Israel shall be saved. As it is written, there shall come out of Zion the deliverer, and shall turn away ungodliness from Jacob. For this is my covenant unto them, when I shall take away their sins. Again, I like to depict things visually. This is like the church 101. This is what the church is. Who's the church? What is the church? Is it the 40,000 Christian denominations that we have? Buildings? Labels? No. Paul tells us point blank, there's this thing, this cultivated olive tree, right? That's Israel. If you believe in Yeshua, great. If you don't, you're a branch that gets cut out. Now, if you're over here in this wild olive tree, that you're not ethnically part of Israel, you have no ancestry that can be traced back to Jacob, you're this Gentile wild olive tree, you accept Yeshua, you get grafted in. It's pretty simple, isn't it? Here's a little cartoon to describe it for you. That's who the church is. We have another example in the two sticks of Ezekiel 37. There's no mystery twig over here called the church somewhere. There's two sticks. I wrote a blog a while back called Pick a Stick, because there's only two. Pick a stick to choose from. And as I'm going through this, I'm realizing, man, there is Yahuwah has one people, one bride, and one plan, which has never changed. John Nelson Darby and others like him are the one who invented what I now call the bogus doctrine of dispensationalism, which has robbed us of our identity, creating division where there never was before. What's ironic, though, is most dispensationalists will listen to me here. There are going to be comments on YouTube. I can already see them. I'm prophetically saying I know what's coming. They will accuse me of saying what I'm saying here is replacement theology. I'm like, no. Okay, guys, if this is what you believe, if you believe for hundreds of years, thousands of years, whatever, it's been Israel, 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 cross, boom, church. You believe in replacement. Not me. I believe in grafting. I believe what Paul said in Romans chapter 11. When I married my wife, Sheila, she had a 13-year-old son. And I didn't want it to be Robin's Sheila Skiba and Jeremiah Garcia. He's going to be part of my family too. And I told him, I took him aside, I said, listen, I'm not just marrying your mother. In essence, I'm marrying you too. I want to give you my name. If you want it, it's yours. And he agreed, he wanted it. He was like, we're all going to be a family? Yeah. So I adopted him, gave him my name. Now, genetically, he's still a Garcia, right? But he's been adopted into my family. He wears my name on his baseball jersey. He has taken on my identity. To whatever degree he chooses, he can participate in my family's traditions. And whatever I have to leave him when I go is his, right? That's grafting. That's adoption, whereby we have the spirit of adoption. We cry, Abba, Father. I mean, Paul is telling us all this stuff. I'm not creating a whole new identity over here. No. We see in Genesis where Jacob is prophesying over his sons, right? You know the story. He crosses his hands over Ephraim and Manasseh. And Joseph's like, no. You know, he's my... And he's like, I know, I got it. I know. You know, he gives a good prophecy over Manasseh, but he says that Ephraim's going to become a multitude of nations. The fullness of the Gentiles is another way to look at this. And that's what's odd to me, is that John Nelson Darby actually got this. And you want to talk about a cult leader. Man, he couldn't get along with the Plymouth Brethren, so he starts his own group over there, and you know, King James wasn't good enough for him, so he created his own translation. Wow. Okay. And looking in the Hebrew, it's Milo HaGoyim, fullness of the Gentiles, multitude of nations. In his translation, he says he will become the fullness of nations, or the fullness of Gentiles. That's what Paul's talking about later when he talks about the fullness of the Gentiles coming in. Not a whole separate group of people. Gentiles, you can look at it this way. There's only one nation that's in covenant with God. One people group. Israel. The family of Israel. They are in covenant. Everybody who's out of covenant are the Gentiles. So a Gentile is an out-of-covenant person. Israel, is the church, is somebody who's in covenant. So it's an oxymoron to say, well, I'm a Gentile believer. No, you're not. You're a believer who was a Gentile. You're not a Gentile believer. It's a contradiction in terms. We see in Hosea 2, again, he says, I will show love to those called not loved, and to those I called not my people, I will say, now you are my people. And they will reply, you are our God. This is what Paul is saying in Romans chapter 9. He says, he does this to make the riches of his glory shine even brighter on those to whom he shows mercy, who were prepared in advance for glory. We are among those whom he selected, both from the Jews and from the Gentiles. Concerning the Gentiles, God says in the book of Hosea, who is he talking about in Hosea? Israel. They just told you who the Gentiles were. You know, Paul's the apostle to the Gentiles. Okay, but who are the Gentiles? Divorced Israel. You ever wonder why Paul's, you know, he's going to all these Greek pagan cities and somehow there's always a synagogue there? You ever think about that? Yeah, because in the diaspora, they were scattered abroad, but everybody knew where they were. If you look at the other disciples, they went to places where they knew they were too. They were going to the lost sheep of the house of Israel. That's why there were synagogues. They were forbidden from going back into the land. So they set up shop and did what they were doing in these other lands. And Paul was going to them and talking to them. He tells you point blank in Romans chapter 9 that he's talking about the Gentiles, and he's quoting Hosea. God says in the prophecy of Hosea, "Those who are not my people, I will now call my people, and I will love those whom I did not love before." Hosea chapter 3. "Then the Lord said to me, 'Go and love your wife again, even though she commits adultery with another lover.' This will illustrate that Yahuwah still loves Israel." I don't know how many of you have ever had to deal with infidelity in your marriage, but short of crucifixion or terminal illness, I can't imagine anything more painful. It's brutal. And this poor guy, this prophet, was actually told to go and marry a prostitute, knowing that she's going to continue to sleep around on him. And God says, "This is to illustrate to you, Hosea, what I'm going through, what I have to deal with." There's a principle that I learned when I was going through all of that, that forgiveness is for you. You. The person who is hurt. It's not for the people who do the hurting. And the reason is because the byproduct of forgiveness is peace. You not forgiving somebody else is like drinking poison and expecting them to get sick. You know, if my brother here, how much do you weigh? About 230 pounds. I weigh about 170 pounds. Let's say this brother here is the one who hurt me. Me not forgiving him, what does that look like? Well, it looks like, you know, I wake up in the morning, I take a shower, you know, I get dressed, and I strap 230 pounds on my back, and I drag him around all day long. How far do you think I'm going to get through my day dragging 230 pounds on my back? I'm not going to get very far. You know, I'm fairly strong, I can lift a fair amount of weight, but I'm not going to get too far dragging him around every day on my back. What if he's not the only one to hurt me? How many people are you strapping on your back every day by not forgiving? They don't deserve my forgiveness. You got it wrong. You deserve to forgive so that you can have peace. I went to this program. That's what brought me to Texas in the first place. And they were trying to tell me this. They're trying to get me to understand this. And they had sort of this role-playing thing where they had this poor girl that was playing my now ex-wife. She was just playing the part of standing there being her. And I was supposed to describe the offenses, name the offense, name the person, choose to forgive, say the words, "I forgive you." And as I was recreating the scenario that she represents, I was getting angrier and angrier and angrier, and I'm like, I can't do it. And they're like, "Fine, okay, Rob, grab your chair and go hold it in the corner." Whatever. You know, they're working in small groups of five people. So they're working with the other four people, and it takes a good 20 minutes or so to go through, you know, for most people. And so, you know, they go through the other four people, and they get done, they come over to me. I'm still holding the chair. Now, it's quite some time later, and, you know, I'm using my knee, I'm putting it on my head, I'm doing whatever, and they're like, "Why are you still holding your chair?" "Well, you told me to!" Like, "Well, look at your arms. They're shaking." "Yeah. They hurt? Yeah. They burn? Yeah." "Well, Rob, what do you think all the unforgiveness is doing in your heart?" "Yeah. You're just holding a chair for 30 minutes or whatever. You're carrying all this stuff and it's eating you alive. It's burning you up, man. You need to forgive for yourself to get peace." Yeah, I get it, but I can't go there. So I go back home, and they told me when I left, it was a three-weekend deal after I left part one, they said, "You're going to experience some speed bumps along the way. Chance to practice your tools." Yeah. So I'm at this fair. There's 140,000 people at this fair. I go into Subway to buy a sandwich, walk out, boom, walk right into her. I mean, what are the chances, right? Well, at least one in 140,000, I guess. So, it turns into this big fight, you know, right there in the middle of the fairground. And right in the middle of the fight, all I could think of was that stupid chair. So I thought, okay, forgiveness is for me, right? Okay. So I grabbed her hand, I looked her in the eye, I said, look, stop, just stop. I said, I forgive you. And she said, for what? I didn't do anything wrong. Oh, forgiveness is for me. I'm going to go cut my chair now. Walk away. That's when it proved the point to me. Because how many of you know the people that have hurt you either don't know or don't care? You know, maybe they did it unintentionally, so they don't know that they really hurt you. But the ones that know that they hurt you, they've gone on with their life. They've figured out some way to justify. I could have given a laundry list of reasons why she did something wrong. But, you know, in her defense, she just did the same thing that we all do. She found a way to justify it. Right? Do we not do the same thing when we do something wrong? We try to justify it. You know, and hurt people hurt people. If you don't get healed, you're just going to pass on that anger, that hurt to somebody else. And that just continues to perpetuate until somebody draws a line in the sand and says, you know what, it stopped here. I'm not going to continue to perpetuate this. I'm going to get healing. I'm going to get forgiveness. Forgiveness is for me. You know? And, you know, we're told to pray for our enemies, right? Not pray that something bad happens to them. Driving by, yeah, I pray she dies of syphilis or some kind of other god-awful, you know, whatever. No. No. Not that I did anything like that or anything. No. Genuinely pray for those that have hurt us. Because in many cases, they've been hurt before too. All they're doing is passing on the hurt that they had. You know, they've got stuff they got to work through. You owe it to yourself to forgive. Now, can we agree, based on what I just said, that forgiveness is for ourselves? That forgiveness is for the one who is offended, not for the offender. Anybody not agree with that? Everybody agrees. Forgiveness is for the one who's offended, not for the offender. Okay. If that's true, then let's consider our relationship with God. Who's the offended in a relationship with God, and who's the offender? What are we? We're the offender. He's the offended. We just all said that we agree that forgiveness is for the offended, not for the offender. So if that's true, then forgiveness is for God. Gerbil just jumped off the wheel. I don't know what's going on. I think he was running real fast, right? Trying to keep up. That's what happened to me. I'm like, I don't know what to do with that. Because I grew up in an environment that taught eternal security but made you feel like you're going to hell if your hair touches your collar, if you're listening to rock music, you know, whatever. So, you know, always having a, you know, we're having an album burning ceremony, you know, after the service. You know, we're going to burn our tapes and records because, you know, if you're playing backwards, it says kill your mother, so. Yeah, forgiveness is for God. Why? Because the byproduct is peace. I know how hard it was for me to forgive the people that hurt me. I remember. I'm never going to forget it. How hard was it for God, the offended, to forgive you, the offender? Wow. You know, I say it was hard for me to forgive. Man, look what he had to go through. Look what Yeshua did. He needed peace so badly with us, the offenders, that he was willing to endure that. Unbelievable. So why do we ask for forgiveness then? It is my opinion that the reason we ask for forgiveness is that's reconciliation. He forgave me 2,000 years before I was even born. He got peace with me before I even was a thought in anybody's head. He's already got peace for me. But then that one day that I got down on my knees and recognized that I was the offender, that I was the adulterer, that I was the one that was constantly hurting God by not following in his ways. When I admitted my sin and asked for forgiveness, he's going, I already did it. But thank you. Now we have a relationship. that we didn't have before. Think about this. What would it be like if the person that hurt you, think about whoever hurt you worse than anybody ever, let's imagine that you have forgiven them. You have total peace with them. One day, they call you up, or they come to your door, totally broken, completely sincere and in tears, acknowledging the pain that they caused you, and they say, "I'm so sorry. I'm so sorry I hurt you." How much sweeter would that peace that you already have be if that ever happened? Can you imagine? Now there's reconciliation. Right? I believe that that's what's happening with us in a relationship with God. I could be wrong. This is how I understand it based on my experiences. And when I look at this text right here and relate the path that brought me here and looking at this and seeing how God was going through the same thing that I went through back in 2002 on a massive scale, and what God went through, and he goes on and says, "So I brought her, I bought her back for 15 pieces of silver and 5 bushels of barley and a measure of wine. Then I said to her, 'You must live in my house for many days and stop your prostitution. During this time, you will not have sexual relations with anyone, not even with me.' This shows that Israel will go a long time without a king or prince and without sacrifices, sacred pillars, priests, or even idols. But afterward, the people will return and devote themselves to the Lord their God and to David's descendant, their king. In the last days, they will tremble in awe of Yahuwah and his goodness." I don't know about you, but I believe we're in the last days. And I am trembling in awe of the Lord and his goodness. That for whatever reason, he found that I was worthy to show some of these things to. To come out of the pig pen and put that thought in my head, "I wonder if Dad will take me back." What happened when the prodigal son returned? Was the father mad with him? Did he give him the third degree? Big feast. Loving arms. That's us. That's that picture I showed you at the beginning of this presentation. All these people all around the world waking up in the pig pen going, "I wonder if Dad will take me back." And he's saying, "Yes, come back. I've been waiting for you to come back." And I sat here earlier looking at about 300 people taking Passover, many of you for the first time, looking at John and John going, "Wow, look at this. That is just nothing short of amazing." Are you amazed by that, or am I just freaking out for no reason? Are you trembling in awe that somehow you found your way not just to this conference, but to this walk? I am. And that's exactly what was prophesied to happen here in the book of Hosea. Leviticus 26, he says, "I set my tabernacle among you, and my soul shall not abhor you, and I will walk among you, and I will be your God, and you shall be my people." He wants to walk with us in the garden the same way he did with Adam and Eve before fellowship was broken. Unfortunately, today, many people think of Yahuwah's law as bondage. Okay, now think about that. They were in bondage, right? So you really think they went through the whole Exodus thing, the plagues, the Red Sea parting, Sinai, all that amazing stuff, just to put them back into bondage? "Congratulations, I've just rescued you from bondage. Now here's my law. Bondage!" What do you think? How does this make sense? It doesn't make sense. No. I'm sure you probably agree, but I see tremendous joy. It started with keeping Sabbath, with an invitation from a friend of mine to attend a Torah study at a Christian bookstore on a Saturday, on Black Friday, of all times. It was when that phone call took place. And then I believe we can, you know, I don't have a problem with people worshiping on Sunday, honestly. I think we should worship every day. But don't think that Sunday replaced the Sabbath. The Sabbath is special. You can worship on Sunday, Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday. You should worship every day. But remember the Sabbath and keep it holy. And that's like he on his day timer, he's got these appointed times, right? These are times that he wants to meet with us. It's date night. You know, he's like, hey, honey, I got something special planned for you this Saturday. Well, I mean, that's awesome, but if you show up on Monday, he's like, well, you know, I appreciate you love me and you want to spend time with me on Monday, but you missed out, man. I had something really, I mean, we can hang out together on Monday, but I had something really special for you the other day. You know, and that's what happened for us. And then we start moving into Passover, our first Passover. We're like, whoa, I mean, how many of you, this is your first Passover? Raise your hand. Wow. Was that special for you? Did you see the significance in the things that was showed to you this morning, this afternoon, whenever it was? Was it more special than Easter bunnies and pork dinner? It was for me. I mean, just looking at all those things and recounting the Exodus and what happened in the time with Israel and the Exodus is amazing. But then when you see how many of those things apply to Yeshua and what he did, wow, so much more significant. I remember the first time that I took that matzah bread and I looked at it with stripes and pierced holes in it, and the person's going, this is my body. This is what he's talking about. And I'm looking at that, and I almost couldn't break it. Because I'm looking at, this is his body that was broken for me. I'm going to break this cracker, but in reality, 2,000 years ago, I'm responsible for his physical body being broken. I broke that cracker for the first time, and man, it was like, almost like in the crack, when that opened up, I saw an open vision of the crucifixion, and like, it's just slayed by that. Powerful stuff. Total freedom. Do you guys feel like you're in bondage this weekend? I don't get it. Leviticus 26, though, goes on to say, but if you will not hearken unto me and will not do all these commandments, and if you shall despise my statutes, or if your soul abhor my judgments, so that you will not do all my commandments, but that ye break my covenant, I also will do this to you. I will even appoint over you terror, consumption, and the burning ague, whatever that is, that shall consume the eyes and cause sorrow of heart. And ye shall sow your seed in vain, for your enemies shall eat it. And I will set my face against you. Ye shall be slain before your enemies. They that hate you shall reign over you. And ye shall flee when none pursues you. Wow. Leviticus 26, pretty hardcore. And if ye will not, yet for all this, hearken unto me. If you don't learn your lesson the first time, I will punish you 7 times more for your sin. What is sin? Transgression of the Torah, according to 1 John 3:4. And I will break the pride of your power, and I will make your heaven as iron and your earth as brass, and your strength shall be spent in vain, for your land shall not yield her increase, neither shall the trees of the land yield their fruits. And if ye walk contrary to me and will not hearken unto me, I will bring 7 times more plagues upon you according to your sins. You think you might get it? You know, first time's going to be bad enough. It's going to get worse. Plagues are coming. The call of the last day is to come out of Babylon. Why? So that you do not partake of her plagues. And what amazes me is I posted something this weekend about ham because I was at a restaurant at the airport and like pork is in everything. And around here, good grief, we were at one restaurant and they had a sign for bacon sundae. An ice cream sundae, bacon sundae. What? It is unbelievable that pork is in everything. And yet even secular scientists who have no dog in this hunt could care less about the Torah. Secular scientists will tell you that stuff's bad for you. You got swine flu and all this other stuff. You look into some of these plagues that people are getting. I think a lot of it, especially in the last days, is going to come upon those who just aren't not obeying God. Come out of Babylon so that you don't partake of her plagues. People say, well, Christians are not appointed unto wrath. That's true. Babylon is appointed unto wrath. But if you decide to stay in Babylon, guess what? You're going to get what's not supposed to be coming to you. Yes, Christians are not appointed unto wrath. Babylon is. Come out of Babylon so you do not partake of her plagues. Now, we see, however, if they shall confess their iniquity and the iniquity of their fathers with their trespass, which they trespass against me, and that also they have walked contrary to me, and that I also have walked contrary to them, and have brought them into the land of their enemies, if then their uncircumcised hearts be humbled, and they then accept of the punishment of their iniquity, then I will remember my covenant with Jacob, and also my covenant with Isaac, and also my covenant with Abraham, and I will remember the land, I believe Eden. Judah went into captivity and served 70 years, 1 year for each of the Sabbath years they did not give the land rest. They went into Babylon. But they learned their lesson, repented, and were thus brought back into the land and remained there until their disobedience got them booted out again in 70 AD. But there's no evidence that Ephraim ever repented when they were put into bondage. The prophet Ezekiel was told to lay on his side for 390 days. 390 days, days representing years. The northern kingdom was to be punished for 390 years. That was their initial judgment for not obeying God. But there's no evidence that they repented. So Leviticus 26 says they got seven times their judgment. So if you look at this, Ephraim's sentence was 390 years according to Ezekiel 4, but since they did not repent, they had seven times the length of punishment added on according to the principle established in Leviticus 26. At one of our Torah studies, my friend Chad wondered if Ephraim received seven times the judgment for not repenting after the 390. If this theory is true, and I tend to think that it is, the 390 years of initial judgment times 7 for not repenting equals 2,730 years. Now, I've been blessed to travel all around the world talking about some of this stuff, and I've asked people, when did you first come into this understanding and start wanting to keep the Sabbath and doing the feasts and Torah and all that? And not always, not everyone, but the vast majority of the people that I talked to were telling me roughly 2009 to 2010 was the time period when they essentially woke up in the pig pen. And that's when I did. And, you know, when I first came into this, I started looking at stuff, started watching people like Zach Bauer with New to Torah, 119 Ministries, Jim Staley. You know, I thought these guys had been around forever. I thought these guys, you know, they were like the gurus that, you know, had this figured out, and somehow I just missed them. Well, then I had to become friends with these guys and start hanging out with these guys and talking with these guys. I come to find out they came in about the same time I did. I'm like, wow, really? And more people, I kept seeing that. Now, there were forerunners. There are some people here that have been around for, you know, in some cases decades. But they were forerunners. There were the voices crying in the wilderness that everybody thought was crazy, you know. But they were the ones growing maturity that God planted ahead of time to be the ones for newcomers that we come along and we think we have it all together, we think we have it all figured out, and they can say, hey, brother, you know, here's something you might want to consider. And they are being like mentors now. But so many people that I have encountered would go back to 2009, 2010. And when you look at when they went into the Assyrian captivity, roughly 721, 722 BC, well, the math is pretty simple. 2,730 years of judgment minus 721 equals 2009. That's what I believe the Ephraim Awakening can be traced back to 2009. Why is this important? Well, Malachi says, for behold, the day cometh that shall burn as an oven, and all the proud, yea, and all that do wickedly shall be stubble. And the day that cometh shall burn them up, saith the Lord of hosts, that it shall leave them neither root nor branch. But unto you that fear my name, not title, shall the Son of Righteousness arise with healing in his wings, and he shall go forth and grow up as calves in the stall. And ye shall tread down the wicked, for they shall be ashes under the soles of your feet in the day that I shall do this, saith the Lord of hosts. Remember ye the law of Moses, end times context. This is an end times context. Remember ye the law of Moses, my servant, which I commanded unto him in Horeb for all Israel with the statutes and judgments. You know, the average evangelical Christian church would tell you the law has been done away with. Oh, but they're all about Malachi chapter 3. You're robbing God if you're not tithing to my building. Oh, you like Malachi? Let's go look at the next chapter, shall we? Chapter 4. Funny how you don't like Malachi so much anymore. What about Paul? Paul was regularly being accused, and still is, isn't he, of being an antinomian, anti-Torah. And he's testifying here, you know, and he's like, but I confess unto thee that after the way which they call heresy, so worship I the God of my fathers, believing all things which are written in the law and prophets. And when you go like to Romans chapter 6, he says, what shall we say then? Shall we continue in sin that grace may abound? God forbid. How shall we that are dead to sin live any longer therein? What is sin, right? 1 John chapter 3, verse 4, sin is transgression of the law. So my wife and I were reading the story with the woman caught in adultery. And you know the story, and you know Yeshua is like, I don't judge you either. And he says, okay, go and sin no more. Well, what was her sin? Adultery. So Sheila says, what if we just change the word sin to the biblical definition of sin? Anywhere we see the word sin in the New Testament, just substitute the word sin with the actual definition of sin, which is transgression of the law. So he says to her, I don't judge you either, therefore go and transgress the law no more. I thought, yeah, no, that's interesting. Let's go back and look at Paul. And this is a fun exercise. So if you're dealing with this on Facebook or anywhere else, just look at, Paul talks a lot about sin, doesn't he? Oh yeah, he does. He talks a lot about sin. Well, everywhere Paul uses the word sin, just don't use that word, use the biblical definition. And here's an example. Let not transgression of the law, therefore, reign in your mortal body, that you shall obey it in the lust thereof. Neither yield ye your members as instruments of unrighteousness unto transgression of the law, but yield yourselves unto God as those that are alive from the dead, and your members as instruments of righteousness unto God. For transgression of the law shall not have dominion over you, for ye are not under the law, but under grace. What then? Shall we transgress the law because we are not under the law, but under grace? God forbid. See how you can turn Paul around in a biblical context? We need to keep Paul. But what about Galatians? Galatians! Could have a whole weekend on Galatians, right? He gives his, you know, he's like, look, you know, you've heard of my conversion in time past in the Jewish religion, how that beyond measure I persecuted the church of God and wasted it and profited in the Jews' religion above many my equals in mine own nation, being more exceedingly zealous in the traditions of my fathers. He was all about the Pharisaical traditions, right? Then later, when he's talking about his conversion and stuff, he says, neither went I up to Jerusalem to them which were apostles before me, but I went unto Arabia and returned again unto Damascus. So he's like, okay, you know, after I had this knock off a horse thing and I, you know, all that, I didn't go to Peter, James, and John or those guys. He went to Arabia. What's in Arabia? Mount Sinai. Mount Sinai is in Arabia. And many say, and I tend to agree, that he was tutored specifically by Yeshua for, some say, about 3 years. Well, he says he went specifically to Arabia. He didn't go anywhere else because you got to think about Paul. He memorized the Torah. He thinks that what these Christians are doing is anti-Torah. So when he's encountering the Yeshua, the living Torah, and realizes, okay, I've been wrong, I don't get it. Well, where, what better place to go to get it than to Sinai? I believe Paul went to Mount Sinai and sat at the feet of Yeshua for 3 years. So do you really think, if that's true, that he came back preaching against the Torah? No. He went to Arabia to figure the deal out. And what I found interesting as I was looking to the Galatians issue is that Peter wrote to the Galatians also. Everybody thinks, you know, Paul wrote to the Galatians, that's it. No. Peter, 1 Peter chapter 1, was giving his greetings. He says to who he's writing, to whom he's writing, and one of the people group that he's writing this letter to is Galatia. So Peter wrote to the Galatians, presumably after Paul did, because he references some things later. And then in 2 Peter, he tells you that his second epistle is also to these. He's like, I write this second epistle to you, the same people he wrote in the first one. And in the end of 2 Peter, he tells them, he's like, look, there's some of the things. He first recognized that Paul's writings were scripture. So he validated Paul. Then he said, but there are some things that Paul says that are hard to understand, that ignorant and unstable people are twisting and distorting and manipulating in order to fall into the error of lawlessness. And I would say parenthetically, 2,000 years later, posting all over Facebook about why we don't need to obey God. Quoting Galatians and Paul. Yeah. Famous last words, right? We you're familiar with the phrase, you know, some famous person says something and you're like, everybody wants to remember, what's the last thing that guy said? Famous last words. Well, the famous last words of the last prophet of the Old Testament, we call the Old Testament, it says that we're to remember ye the law of Moses in an end times context. The last writer of the New Testament, the Apostle John, said in 1 John chapter 5, for this is the love of God, that we keep his commandments. His commandments are not grievous. John also wrote the last book in what we call our Bible. In Revelation 14, he says, here is the patience of the saints. Here are they that keep the commandments of God and the faith of Yeshua. I'm going to wrap this up. There's a video I saw online. This individual does this little skit, and it's like Law and Grace for Dummies kind of thing. So we might need to check the volume on this again. But I'm going to play this video of this individual explaining in such a profound way how law and grace works.
I want my seven children, and I should be back on time. Thank you, Art, and thank you, Pastor Cisneros. And this is a little thing I've always done, and I always enjoy talking to intelligent audiences, and these precious little children are going to help me. Now, I'm going to name these children, and I want you to learn their names. I want to see if you can do what other audiences have done. The first one we're going to name, let's not name them. Let's just say, when I point to this one, sin. What is it?
Sin.
Come on, everybody. What is it?
Sin.
Once more.
Sin.
This one is law. Who is this?
Law.
Who is it?
Law. Sin. Law.
This is grace. Who is this?
Grace.
Once more.
Grace.
Let's go backward.
Grace. Law. Sin.
That's very good. Let's go again.
Sin. Law. Grace.
Savior. Who is this?
Savior.
Savior. Come on. Now, this one is gospel. What is it?
Gospel.
Let's see if we can go now.
Sin, law, grace, Savior, gospel.
Pastor Ortiz, we got another good audience. Now let's do it all the way to the end. This is?
Sin, law, grace, Savior, gospel.
This is preacher. Who is this?
Preacher.
And this one is church. What's his name?
Church.
Church. Now, let's go and let's quote the Bible. The Bible says, who says?
Bible.
The Bible says that is the transgression of God's
law.
Are you with me?
Yes.
Let's do it one more time. The Bible says that
sin
is the transgression of
law.
Whoever hates
sin
must uphold the
law.
Whoever fights the
law
is upholding
sin,
whether he likes it or not. Now, ladies and gentlemen,
grace.
Come on, ladies and gentlemen,
grace
is pardon for
sin,
which is breaking the
law.
Very good. Let's do that one more time.
Grace
is pardon for
sin,
which is breaking the
law,
and the
Savior
died that we might have
grace,
which is pardon for
sin,
which is breaking the
law,
and
Savior
gave us the
law,
which is the good news about the
Savior.
Now the
preacher
preaches the
gospel
in his
church.
Now today, you've got men fighting God's law in church. And they say that the
law
is done away with. You may go, darling. Now, if you do away with the
law,
the Bible says where there is no law, there is no
sin.
So you may go, darling. And if you do away with
sin,
you don't need
grace,
which is pardon for sin, which is breaking the law. And if you don't need grace, you certainly don't need a
Savior
who died that we might have grace, which is pardon for sin, which is breaking the law. And in that case, you don't need a, because it's the story of a Savior who died that we might have grace, which is pardon for sin, which is breaking the law. And if that be true, what in the world do you need a
preacher?
And if you don't need him, you might as well throw away the.
Perfect, isn't it? What a great little analogy. Is it starting to make sense? There's more to say, but we're going to run out of time. I know I don't want to take up other speakers' time also, but I'm excited because this Ephraim Awakening is the love story of how Yahuwah redeemed his unfaithful bride. And as we are mikra these things, to rehearse these things, I, like I said, I've done a lot of theater. And when I write and direct plays, I like to do a lot of rehearsals. And then I'll tell all my actors, okay, actors, stay home. Get some rest. I need to work with the technical crew now. I need to work with the lighting guy, the sound guy, the prop guy, the fog machine guy, the special effects guys. I need to work with them. So I'll go through one or two tech rehearsals until I am absolutely certain that everybody knows their job, they all know their timing, and they hit it all perfectly. So the lights do what they're supposed to do, the sound, everything's the way it needs to be, all the props are where they're supposed to be at the right time. And then I call for a dress rehearsal. And in the dress rehearsal, it's as if it's the main event. There's no do-overs. If you flub a line, you got to go with it. You know, something messes up, you got to go with it. We have that dress rehearsal as if it's the main event. And then the main event comes, the crowd comes, the curtains open, and it's showtime. I was at a conference at Norm Franz's congregation for a Passover, and he was talking about some of this stuff and how everybody's fighting over when's the new moon? Is it a conjunction moon? Is it a crescent moon? Is it a lunar Sabbath? Do we even care about the moon? You know, everybody's fighting about how do you pronounce God's name, or when is Passover really, or is it the Enoch calendar, or is it the sun? Is it the what? When does the day begin? Look, guys, we have been in exile for 2,730 years, thoroughly entrenched in paganism. We have inherited a lot of lies. Do you really think we're going to figure it all out in 7, 8, 10 years? No. Why can't we come and reason together as civilized human beings and talk some of these differences out instead of labeling everybody a heretic or giving them, you know, the right hand of fellowship followed by the left boot of, you know, excommunication because they don't agree with you? Or thinking we have it all figured out, so we're going to go to another congregation that doesn't have it figured out and go straighten everybody out. I believe, and I said this to Norm Franz, I said, you know, brother, it is my opinion that I think if God is in fact following sort of that same structure with this idea of rehearsals, that maybe we're in tech rehearsal phase. We're still trying to figure the technical stuff out. And we're not going to get it all right. We're at this point, we're like children drawing pictures for our daddy that barely look like stick figures, and we're presenting it to him thinking it's our masterpiece, and our loving father just appreciates the fact that you drew this picture for him, and he appreciates it. He says, you know what, son? You know what, daughter? Good job. Hangs it up on the refrigerator. As messy and crazy as it looks. But as we continue to practice our drawing skills in this analogy, our pictures get better and better and better. Until one day he's bragging because you're in the newspaper or on TV for whatever you did or whatever. Because you got better at it. I think right now we're presenting our Heavenly Father with scribbles that are making it on the heavenly refrigerator. You know, and your scribble's not better than mine. We're trying with the best information we have to honor him. And I have to believe, it's my opinion, that the two witnesses of the last days, scripture says that it takes how many to establish truth? Two minimum, 2 to 3, to establish truth. I am of the opinion that one of the functions of the two witnesses in the last days is going to be to get us all in sync. Right now we're doing this. They're going to go, bing, aha, there you got it. Now we know when the year begins. Now we know when the week, the month begins. We know when the Sabbath begins. Awesome. Tech rehearsal. Let's do a, you know, maybe time and a half kind of thing. A couple more rehearsals. And then the big main event's going to come. But by then, I think we're going to be...
That was me.
Okay. Time's up, Rob. The little cane is going to pull me off. Then we'll be ready. You know, like our sister said earlier, we're going to go through some plagues. I used to be a hardcore pre-trib rapture guy. Then I started looking through the scriptures for myself and said, well, that's not in there. After the tribulation of those days, you shall see the Son of Man coming in the clouds. Yeshua said, after the tribulation of those days. Paul said, we meet him in the clouds. Yeshua said, the only time I'm going to be in the clouds is afterwards. Okay. Wow, that's scary. Now what? Because I had this attitude, I don't have to worry about any of that stuff. I'm out of here. I'll fly away, oh glory. So practicing my rapture shoot jump. I got some stories I could tell about that, but anyway. When I realized, no, it's after, I got real sober about all of this and thought, okay, I got to understand this stuff, because he's got a plan and he's executed it perfectly on the Moedim his first time around. He's got a really good track record, which means I believe Yeshua is the main actor, the main character in this divine play. He knows his lines perfectly. He knows his mark and he hits them perfectly every time. And in his second coming, he's going to do it. I believe he's going to hit. I think we're not done with Passover, unleavened bread, and first fruits and Pentecost. I think there's still more for that stuff too. But I think a lot of it's going to play out in the fall feast thing. So we need to start rehearsing it. So we're at the right place at the right time so that when he comes and the last trump shall sound, not the last trump before seven more trumps. Pre-tribbers. Last trump, not the last trump before seven more. When the dead in Christ shall rise first. How many resurrections are there? How many first resurrections are there anyway? So that we're at the right place, at the right time, when he comes, because he's got a plan. He's not waiting for you, right? We're waiting on him. And when we're in the right place at the right time, and when he shows up at the right place at the right time, we can go with him. We may experience 3 of the 10, maybe. I think we probably will. But I think we're also going to be preserved for the remainder of it in an earthbound terrestrial place of safety, our Goshen. And when I was freaking out about all this, you know, I was a Boy Scout Army guy, you know, I'm, you know, the 4 G's, right? God, gold, guns, and groceries. Got to be a prepper. I'm going to be here for the rapture, and I mean, for the tribulation. I better have my God, gold, guns, and groceries stocked up. Well, I didn't have the financial means to do that, so I was freaking out. And Norm Franz said, no, your Goshen is wherever God has you. God had Israel in the land of Goshen from the time of Joseph. He had them in a place. That's the place that he preserved them. I am of the firm belief that your Goshen is wherever God has you. And that when the time comes, if he wants us to be somewhere else, I could walk out that door and end up in wherever he wants me to be. Let's get on God's page. He did a lot for us. It's the least we could do for him. Thank you.
Thanks so much for watching. I hope you enjoyed this video presentation. If you did, please subscribe to my YouTube channel, like the video, and share it on your favorite social media sites. There's a lot more to come, so stay tuned, and we'll see you back next time.